I can have your attention, please. Thank you. Thank you very much. Can I start by saying good evening to all of you? Good evening. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation and coming to this book launch today. I think you'll appreciate that the significance goes way beyond what you see here today, and the impact is potentially far-reaching beyond what any of us can imagine. This is how things happen in life. I was just thinking to myself from a quote that I saw some months ago, and it simply said, there are three kinds of people, Mopenyu. There are people who make things happen. There are people who watch things happening. But there's a third group of people, and I believe these people have no idea what's happening whatsoever. I'm happy to report this evening that we are here for a young man who makes things happen. So Tomo, thank you for bringing us together. Let's give him a round of applause. Talking about enterprising young Zimbabweans, many of you might have seen one or two jokes making the rounds recently. And one of them has to do with another young Zimbabwean, Nangagaita Medicine, who decides that the environment has become too difficult for him. And he decides that he will try his medical practice in America. And when he gets to America, he is even more frustrated until he gets to the point where he decides that he will practice his medicine from home. So in doing so, this young man puts a sign outside Bambabaki. And the sign simply says, $20 for medical treatment and $100 if you are not recovered by the end of the session. So you know, Zimbabweans, that we are very ingenious. So an American lawyer sees this and decides, let me take this young man on. And he goes in there and he says, doctor, I have a problem because I fear I have lost my sense of taste. And the doctor says, okay, let me call my nurse. And the nurse comes along and the nurse says, doctor, what would you like me to do? And the doctor says, go to box number 22 and get the ointment out of the box and bring it to our patient and put 3 drops on his tongue. So the nurse does this. And at the end of it, the lawyer says, this is foul tasting. This tastes like diesel. And the Zimbabwean doctor says, congratulations, your sense of taste has been restored. $20, please. So the young lawyer is not impressed at all, and he goes back and he decides, no, I must find out more so that I can find out what this young man is doing. So he goes back, and the next time he says, doctor, I have come back, and this time I have lost my memory. So again, the doctor orders his nurse to go back and get the ointment from box number 22 and to put 3 drops on the tongue. But this time, as the nurse approaches the lawyer recognizes the ointment and says, doctor, this is exactly what you gave me last time. And the doctor says, congratulations, your memory has now been restored. $20, please. So this time now he is angry because he's been defeated twice. So he goes away. And then he decides, I'll go back there. And this third time I am going to get him. So he goes back and he says, doctor, I fear I am losing my sight. And my eyesight is getting weaker and weaker. So as I say, Zimbabweans are very ingenious. And he says, I'm afraid we do not have the right medicine for you. The best I can do for you, since we don't have the proper medication, is just to give you $100 and go and seek treatment elsewhere. Here is the $100, and he hands it over. And the lawyer says, excuse me, this is not $100, this is $100. This is $1 rather. And then, of course, the doctor says, congratulations. Your eyesight has now been restored. May I have my $30, please? So I like that story because in many ways it shows the capacity that we have as a people to do what is necessary in what is really a most difficult time. And I think we cannot overemphasize what Togmo has achieved in being able to get us all into this one room and to have done what he has done in producing a book. But I think for me, the significance is a young man who has had a vision and he has chosen to take action. There are many, many studies done of successful people, and they will talk about two main qualities of successful people. And these two qualities are normally two. They are the ability to focus and the ability to concentrate. So the ability to focus is very much like what these young men are doing with their cameras. You will see from time to time, they will keep adjusting. And the reason they do that is that they want to make sure that the main subject of that photograph is exactly what they produce. And I think it's the same with what we are going through in this country. We have to keep the main thing the main thing. What can we do to serve other people? In fact, what can we do to serve the greatest number of other people profitably? But I think the key word is to serve. How can we serve other people? And it's exactly the same with concentration. When you start doing something, start it and finish it without diversion and without losing focus. So for all those reasons, well done, Togmo. We are really looking forward to a great evening and to hear your perspective on the book that you have produced. So let me not take too much more time. Pastor Madzinga is here with us and he is going to give us an opening prayer. So if Pastor Madzinga can come forward and give us that opening prayer. Ah, and here he is. Good to meet you, Pastor. I think we all need a prayer.
Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we would like to glorify your name for this opportunity that we have had to gather around these tables. Heavenly Father, for this cause, which is a national cause, which is a patriotic idea to sustain our economy, I pray that you bless this gathering, bless the minds and the attitude of all them that are present. Help us and help the purpose to prosper in the right direction for the benefit of us all, for the benefit of the nation, for your glory, that it comes back to you. We pray that you help us through and let you take control and make sure this meeting and this gathering, this presentation, this launch is a success. I ask for this in the wonderful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Pastor, I'll ask you to stay with us because I know you'll take over shortly. But before I hand it back to you, I think it's interesting that we have a man from the church because today he will motivate all of us to keep listening, I guess. And I'm talking about motivation because many of us go to church, but we don't really understand the aspect of motivation. And because you are in the church, I'm sure you'll have noticed what I'm going to talk about. A story is told of a man who every week would sit in the front bench at church. And as the pastor was delivering, this man would continually interject and he would say, use me Lord, all throughout the sermon. And after a month or two, the pastor, just like this one, noticed that he had this congregate who was very keen to help. And he would continue shouting, use me Lord. So he thought he would take him up on his offer. And after one of the services, he said to the man, let me see you afterwards. The church needs you. And then he gave this man afterwards a set of duties to repair the benches, broken windows, the floors, polishing, etc. And after 2 weeks of doing this, the man was very tired. And the pastor noticed that the next Sunday, he didn't sit in front anymore. This time he was sitting at the back. And as he preached, he did raise his hand high. It was only halfway, and he was going, use me, Lord. But Lord, please, only in an advisory capacity. I do not think that's the kind of motivation we are here for, but I'm sure you will clarify for us. So thank you, Pastor. Please continue.
God bless you all. May I take this grand opportunity just to express my humility and gratitude to have this opportunity to stand before you. I haven't got much to say, knowing and being conscious that this is not my event. I just want to say something. I'm a bit inspired by this young man, and he is kind of, I'm taught that words are thoughts expressed. So I talk more, has got good thoughts in his mind, in his good brains, and he has expressed them into that book. And after words are said, they must be manifested. And this is kind of a responsibility that I'm expecting our good Lord to help our precious young brother to be able to manifest. I think about it on a more like a national responsibility platform. Why? Because myself being a Christian, I always refer myself and my brethren to the nation of Israel. When Israel entered into Canaan, each tribe was allocated their prophetic land or a piece of that small nation. And now, each tribe from that piece of land that they got from Joshua, the responsibility and the benefits of that land was supposed to be a patriotic one. By that I mean, besides sustaining their own families, each tribe was supposed to use that piece of land to sustain the economy of Israel. Now Zimbabwe is blessed by many natural resources, and I want to thank God for creating gods. Now we have young people like Tokmo, who are blessed by a good mind, which will know how to use the valuable resources, the gods and the land, to contribute towards the economy of Zimbabwe as a whole. And my prayer is that he's going to have that opportunity to manifest what is in that book, so that one day those gods walk out of that book into someone's land, into someone's pastures, for the benefit of the nation. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor. So without further ado, we will move on with our program, because the young man himself will come through now and address us. And I think the way that he will do that, and I'll ask our technical crew to come through so that, they're there, so that we can prepare the slideshow. And as they do that, I'm sure Tokmo is now ready to take us through some of what his thinking is. Take this off, I guess, with you already. But let's put our hands together for Tokmo Zitaya, who will now come through and take over. Well done, Tokmo.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank you all for coming to this special occasion, the launch of my book. I would like to express my gratitude to the Director of Livestock Research, Mr. Sikosana, for taking your time and attending my book launch, and your team, I thank you. I would like also to acknowledge the presence of my family. I would like also to acknowledge the supervisor who supervised me in this project. In his absence, he's not with us today, he failed to come. And I would like to thank you all for coming here. Very special. You've made my day very special. I would like to thank you all for taking your time to come to me to this special occasion. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to do a slideshow, a video clip first before I go on to my presentation. So I'm just waiting for him to... Thank you.
Dairy goat production has been gaining popularity in many countries of the world in the recent years and among the small-scale farmers. This has been caused by the increasing demand of goat milk due to its unique and equally important nutritional value and the fact that goats do not require large areas to keep them. Goats contribute a significant proportion towards national economies worldwide, and this is projected to increase in the coming years. Small-scale farmers, especially those in remote areas, and the landless are gradually recognizing the potential of goats as a low-cost solution to their poor resource endowments. Therefore, goats deserve greater attention at both the macro and micro levels. Despite the fact that dairy goats can generate a lot of income, many smallholder farmers often do not realize these potential benefits. The increase in human population is leading to increased land pressure. This means that dairy goats are a better option since the smaller land sizes cannot support dairy cattle. If we promote goat milk production, we will be able to address the Millennium Development Goals of alleviating extreme poverty and hunger. Goat milk production in the smallholder areas of Zimbabwe is therefore a good pathway out of poverty. However, the goat sector in Zimbabwe is still facing a lot of challenges. Farmers are losing a large number of animals due to mortality, instead of being used productively for consumption and sale. Low goat productivity keeps farmers at the stage of subsistence farming, trying to secure the survival of their existing goat herds. As a result, farmers have not been realizing the full potential of goat farming as a viable source of livelihoods for a long time. In Zimbabwe, the high levels of wastages of 45% through mortality and predators in the goat production sector. Goats in the smallholder areas of Zimbabwe have relatively low kidding rates of 76% instead of the expected value of close to 100%. Goats are being undervalued by farmers. There is also no investment in improved husbandry, lack of business orientation, and lack of formal marketing mechanisms. In Zimbabwe, it was identified that high numbers of mortalities are the key challenge that restrict small-scale farmers from realizing the maximum benefits from their goats. It is against this background that I did an investigation and wrote a book on factors influencing goat milk production in the smallholder areas of Zimbabwe.
Thank you very much. We move on to the slide presentation now. Okay, first I will introduce the topic of my book. The book is entitled The Economics of Goat Milk Production. That's the bigger topic. The subtitle is The Social Economic Factors Influencing Goat Milk Production in the Smallholder Areas of Zimbabwe. This was a research project that I did, and it was published by a German publishing company which is known as Lambert Academic Publishers. It was published on October 28, 2015. Before I talk more about goat milk production, I'll talk briefly about Talkmore. I'm a holder of a Bachelor of Science Honours degree in Agricultural Economics from the University of Zimbabwe, 2018. So when I did this research project in 2018, we published a research paper in a journal entitled Livestock Research for Rural Development in 2014 as a research paper. It was from that research paper that this German company noticed this research project and approached me and decided to publish this book, which was published last year. Currently, I'm a trainee estate manager. I'm working for African Sun and I'm based at Elephant Hills Resort in Victoria Falls. That's briefly about Talkmore's there. Then I'll move on to my objective. I'm sure some of the questions that some of you are asking, why are we talking about goat milk? Why are we changing? Are we changing from cow milk or to goat milk? What's so special about cow milk? What is this goat milk going to bring into our life? What transformation, what value is it going to get into our economy? So to answer those questions, I'm sure some of you have got those questions in the back of your minds. I will explain how this book is going to answer those questions. First and foremost, I will describe the objective for what motivated me to do this study. I wanted to describe gold production in general in Zimbabwe. Gold production in the small water areas of Zimbabwe, the challenges that are facing that farmers are facing, what the current gold production sector is like in Zimbabwe. That was the aim of my book. That was the general aim. Then I also wanted to determine and analyze the socio-economic factors that are influencing gold peak production in the small water areas of Zimbabwe. So what I wanted to find out is, I was looking from a global perspective. Dead gold production has been gaining popularity in many countries around the world. And this is projected to increase in the coming years. But however, in Zimbabwe, I wanted to find out first, are we keeping goats for milk production, or milk production is just a secondary purpose of keeping goats in Zimbabwe? And from there, what can we do to transform that that current scenario of just producing milk as a secondary purpose to a primary reason of keeping goats in the small areas of Zimbabwe? So I wanted to do, and I did an analysis of the social economics that affect the production of goat milk in the small areas of Zimbabwe. The aim was, after analyzing those factors, I wanted to come up with strategies that we can use to improve goat milk production in the small areas of Zimbabwe. So that was the research objective that I had in mind. So I was trying to look at the current scenario that is in Zimbabwe in terms of goat milk production, and then come up with strategies of how to improve on that. Perhaps the next question that can come into somebody's mind: why are we so concerned about goat milk? Or are we changing from cow milk to goat milk? What's so special about goat milk? So I will explain the advantages that comes along with goat milk production. When I look at goat milk is, when you compare it to cow milk, it's more nutritious as compared to cow milk. When we are looking at a global situation whereby we are facing challenges of HIV and AIDS. So goat milk, it has been found that it is recommended to HIV positive patients. Why? Goat milk has got high protein molecules as compared to other types of milk. So its protein molecules can be easily be absorbed by the body, and as a result, they tend up to boost antibodies. So the goat milk is highly recommended to HIV patients. So if you promote goat milk production, it means we are addressing another challenge that we are facing of this HIV pandemic. So goat milk will tend to help us on that. That's another issue. Then another issue is, when we look at goat milk and analyze it, it has been found to have the same nutritional profile as compared to human milk or breast milk. When we compare the amount of proteins, when we compare the amount of fats, when we compare the amount of lactose that is present in goat milk, it's just the same. It's the same as human milk. So what it means is, you can substitute for those mothers who opt not to breastfeed their children. They can use goat milk as a substitute for that. So that's another advantage of goat milk. Then goat milk has got other advantages in that it has got buffering capacity. It is easy to digest in the human system. It has got many medicinal uses. Mr. Skosana, and I hope you don't mind sharing if I share what we discussed some other time about goat milk. You won't mind. You won't worry. Alright. But me. Oh, that's fine. Alright. When you compare goat milk to cow milk, it is very richer than cow milk. because it contains certain nutrients that are present in it that are not present in cow milk. For example, nutrients such as ionosium, vitamin A, they are more present in goat milk as compared to cow milk. So it is more nutritious than cow milk. Then goat milk is also good for those patients who are suffering from ulcers. So that's another plus point for goat milk. Then when we are looking at the current scenario in Zimbabwe, many of our smallholder farmers, they are voting smaller land sizes. So that means if you want to venture into milk production, goats are a better option as compared to cow, because the smaller land sizes can only be supported by goats. You can only sustain goats, not dairy cattle. If you are holding the smaller land sizes, goats are a better option, because goats require less resources. So they are a better option to poor resource endowed farmers. And when comparing to the inputs that you need for goat farming and for dairy farming, yeah, you need a lot of investments as compared to goats. So goats they are a good solution to the poor resource endowed farmers. So that's another plus point for goat milk. So considering that in all those benefits of goat milk, this led me to then analyze that why are we not venturing into goat milk production, and why are we not investing in goat milk production and use it as a way of alleviating extreme poverty and hunger, improving our economy through goat milk production, invest in goat milk production, and eventually commercialize it into dairy goat farming. So those are the advantages of goat milk production. So I will describe in brief, the research methodology that I when I refer to research methodology, I'm just explaining the way I did my research in terms of the way I did my research, the research instruments that I used, the research methods that I used, how I analyzed my data. So I did a case study in Mulilima East, that's in Plumtree. Mainly, if you're looking in Zimbabwe, goat milk is more common in Matabele province, not in other provinces. When you go to other provinces, you see the smaller goats, but when you go to Matabele, you see bigger goats. And more farmers in Matabele, those are the farmers that are more into milking of goats as compared to Mashona. So I did that study in Plumtree. Then it was a cross-sectional survey of 40 farmers. Then from the data that I collected, I used descriptive statistics to analyze the data, and I also used the econometric model. The econometric model is that I used is that one which is below. I will not much emphasize on this. You can refer to the book, but just for emphasis, why is referring to the goat output, goat milk output, that is the amount of goat milk that is produced by a goat per day. Because I wanted to measure the volume of goat milk that is produced by a goat per day. Because normally dairy breeds of goats, they are expected to produce 2 liters or more, just about 2 liters per day for a goat. But in Zimbabwe, from what I measured, we're producing about 300 mils from a goat. So it means there's still a lot to do. So those are the X1, the X2, the X3, those are the variables that I wanted to measure. What I wanted to do is I wanted to test my hypothesis. I wanted to test whether these factors, number of years the farmer has been rearing goats, cost of disease, and other factors, I wanted to measure how they can affect goat milk production. Then after assessing how they can affect, then I can then come up with a recommendation that from this current scenario, what can we do then to improve goat milk production? So that is the model that I used. Then I'll talk about the conceptual framework that I used. This one is now, I'm looking at it from a national point of view, how goat milk production is affected, not just from a farm level. I'm looking at it from a macroeconomic perspective. from various angles or various sectors, how they can affect Godwin production. Because it's not only about the farmer. It comes from policy. Policy is the major issue that affects, that will tend to affect Godwin production. Policy, when I talk about policy, I'm talking about the governance, the various agri-economic policies that we have in place, how they affect the institutional factors. Institutional factors, I was looking at market, I was looking at extension provision, I was looking at credit. All these are affected by policy. And these institutional factors, they tend to affect our production factors. Our production factors, when you're talking about goat milk, it's the breeds, the veterinary medicines that we use, the feeds, all those, they are affected by institutional factors. If you are able to get credit, that will affect, extension also affects these production factors. Then from institutional factors, we go on to farm production efficiency. That's how the farmer now uses those resources in producing. So all those is coming from policy. Then all of those, they will tend to affect our goat milk output. So if you want to commercialize, if you want to improve on goat milk production, it has to come from policy. It goes to institutional factors. Credit. Do we have credit for our farmers? Do we have, what are the marketing channels that are there? What are the extension provision services that are there? Are we disseminating farmers from researchers to back to the farmers? All that will tend to affect our milk output. So if we want to make this work, we need to work all around all those areas so that we improve on goat milk production. So briefly, those were the results that I did. I will just explain briefly. From the variables that I was measuring, I wanted to measure the number of education years attended by households with an effect on goat milk output. I also wanted to measure if cost of disease control. Because the major problem in goat milk production is diseases. So cost of disease is a major issue. Cost of labor and the number of does. A doe is a female goat. So from those factors, from my regulation, the factors that I found out that they had an impact, or that I found out to be affecting goat milk production were number of education years and cost of disease control. So from that, I wanted to come up now with a solution. I found out that those factors, they affect milk production. What then can we do if we are to improve on goat milk production? Then this is the discussion of the results that I managed to get. From my analysis, I wanted to find out, are we keeping goats for milk? Or milking goats is just a secondary issue? Because that's the starting point. If you are keeping them primarily, then it means we need to improve. But if it's not primary, it means if you are to decide it to be primary, then what are we supposed to do as a starting point? Then from the research, goats in Zimbabwe, the majority of our farmers, they keep goats not for milk production, but milk is just a product for goat keeping. They are not like what other countries are doing. So if you want to improve on that, it means we have to import breeds, the correct dairy breeds, so that we start on that. Then the other result is the cost of late disease and number of education. I found all those factors were significant factors that were affecting goat production. The other observation that I made is, looking at the livestock sector of Zimbabwe, I discovered that goat population, I did a trade analysis for the goat population, and discovered that goat's population are increasing, while the cattle production is declining. So what then can we do to improve our livestock sector in Zimbabwe, to improve our economy from that? Then I also discovered that about 73% of our farmers, they are just keeping goats for income. The reason why they are keeping goats is for income generation. Then meat is 22.5%. Then milk is only 5%. So if you want to enjoy all those benefits of goat milk, it means we need to start improving on all the reasons why we are keeping goats. And the average milk that is produced by a goat in Zimbabwe from those small water farmers is about 290 milliliters. The other reason that is affecting goat milk production in Zimbabwe is people for that negative, they still have that negative misconception towards goat milk. Due to taste and preference, they prefer cow milk because they are used to having cow milk. So they don't like goat milk because they are used to cow milk. So that other factor that is affecting goat milk production in the smaller areas of Zimbabwe. The other reason is the smaller quantities of milk that are being produced. And cultural reasons, they tend to affect people. There's two what you want to cultural practice that goat milk is not for consumption. So from that, I then come up with policy recommendation. What can we then do as a nation if you want to commercialize goat milk production in smaller areas of Zimbabwe? The first issue that we have to tackle on is we are keeping goats not for milk production. So if you decide to venture into this, it means we have to import the correct breeds, the dairy breeds. Then we start, that's the starting point. Then the other issue, the major issue that is affecting goat production in Zimbabwe, whether it's goat milk or goat meat production, it's mainly diseases. That's the major issues. Our smallholder farmers, they don't have resources to buy those veterinary medicines to treat their diseases. So in a way, we can then promote and then develop a smaller para-veterinary programs in smaller areas of Zimbabwe so that farmers can have easy access to veterinary medicines to venture into goat milk production. So that's the brief what's the book that I wrote. So at this juncture, I'll welcome any questions. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm looking for resources, then I'm planning to start a pilot project. If funds come up, I'll start a pilot project on goat production. I'm thinking of, if funds permit, I'll get the right breeds and then venture into dairy goat production so that we can, again, walk the talk. But thank you.
Thank you very much, Togmo. And while we ponder the questions we may want to ask Togmo, please keep them with you, because for now we have the Chitombo Rwizi Network who are going to give us an address. Do we have a representative from them to come forward now? Thank you very much.
Thank you. They say with God all things are possible. I don't know if Mr. Munetsi is here from Nestle. No, he isn't. Mr. Mtamadeng. He is a milkman from Nestle. But we are obviously talking about God today. I'm wearing a number of hats, so I just want to congratulate Togmo from the University of Zimbabwe Head, because I'm a council member from there. Well done for publishing your book, because that's what we are encouraging. Number two, I'm also wearing the hat from the Ministry of SMEs. I'm a board member of the Ministry of SMEs. We want to see more young people initiating ideas rather than eating drugs on the street. Like the MC said, there are people who make things happen. We are happy to see what Togmo is doing. Let me go back to the Chitongoro Youth Act, where I come from. What is the Chitongoro Youth Network? Basically, it's a development association started in Chitongoro, which is in Mashonaland West. And basically what we did was, as daughters and sons of Chitongoro, we grew up in those areas, and our father bought those farms in the 1950s and so on. What we decided was to give back to the community. And the members of the association, I'll mention a few, Dr. Mombeshora, Dr. Chombo, and many others. Vamuzari Rinye, who was one of the founders of that network. And initially, it was just to get our colleagues together, come up with ideas, and then we had it registered as a development association. In no time, we were able to achieve quite a number of things. Maidarangwa here is the vice chairperson. We are also gender sensitive. She's the vice chairperson of the Chitongoro Network. Within a few years, when we grew up, Taishan Samarambi, a paraffin. When you go to Chitongoro, most of the farms are electrified. This was one of the achievements of the network. We started building, improving schools in the schools where we come from. Matora Njera School, where we started, we built a computer room, and some computers were donated. In recent years, about 3-4 years ago, Mr. Mzariri was working with Nestle as the headmaster at one of the schools, and Nestle was doing a nutritional program, giving milk to school children. And he said, "Where are you getting your milk from?" And they said, "Well, we've got farmers who produce the milk." And he also said, "In Chitongoro, we've got some farms." And basically, we have got an association which has got more than 400 farms. So we took the directors and the technical people from Nestle to see what we, the farms which we had. And basically, their comment was that you guys are sitting on gold. Because if you look at those farms, altogether, you are looking at 40,000 worth of land. The farms are of a size of about 100 hectares to 250 hectares. And nothing much was happening on those farms. So, but the passion to develop was there. So with Nestle, we went into a relationship, into a partnership, which has been very successful so far. So far, we've got more than 50 farmers which have been trained. Already, 100 cows have been brought in, pregnant cows. They are already starting to produce. And of the 50 farmers who were trained, 20 are already already have got the cows. And one of the things, because the idea of the development association is to transform people's lives to ensure that they get income. On a weekly basis, Nestle is collecting milk from these farmers. And on a fortnightly basis, money, these farmers have already opened with one of the banks. Every fortnight, money is going into these farmers' accounts. This is one of the very good examples which we are doing. When Tokmo told me about this book, we also said in Chitongoro we want the land and the opportunities that we can also embrace your ideas. And I've got Mr. Kasande here as well, and he'll be talking to you later. He's a former MD of Nestle and a former president of CZI. We have a big dream for our country. And I wearing the same hat as he does to see the country developing, to see ourselves making a difference. And we have been sharing on things which can be done. in terms of creating opportunities, not only for the urban people, but in the rural economies. The idea of goats, I remember when we were talking to the farmers in one of the meetings, there are so many advantages. I think you gave us 8 advantages, but there are a lot more. If you look in terms of, you know, in terms of, it's not only the milk, which you are also going to have, but people can also use them for the meat. And it's not only that we can, even the byproduct, the hides, and then there's also the value addition element. The milk we are producing, it can be turned into yogurt, into ice cream, and all those things. These activities can be done on the farms in terms of value addition. And by so doing, we are creating employment within the communities. So there are so many opportunities. We can, you know, the seed you have planted can be developed into a lot of opportunities. So we can only say, talk more, well done, and keep up the good seed you have planted.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mzarili, for your kind words and indeed for your encouragement. I think the saying goes that if you want to go to a particular place, walk in the footsteps of those who have walked before you. And I think in many ways your speech exemplifies that. So we thank you for the direction that you are offering this young man. Indeed, some of us were young once upon a time. So it's good to see young men doing good things. We move on now, and we'd like to request of our guest of honor to also give us a perspective on this evening and indeed, in the broader scheme of things, what he feels about this latest initiative. So, ladies and gentlemen, can I ask that we put our hands together for our guest of honor here this evening, Mr. Skosana.
Thank you, Master of Ceremony. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Joseph Kosana from the Ministry of Agriculture, Mechanization and Irrigation Development. And I'm in the Department of Research and Specialist Services, and I'm responsible for livestock and pastures research. And livestock pastures research has got 4 institutes in the country. Those are research stations. That is Matopos, Makuholi, Henderson, and Grasslands. These institutes were established in such a way that they have to cater for the agroecological zones where they are in the communities. And what's very interesting, we are mandated to develop technologies to support our farmers nationally. As I've mentioned, you can see how these stations are located, they're strategic. And all of them, except Makuholi, they do keep goats. And for your own interest, I've been working on goats for more than 20 years at my Topos Research Station before I came to Harare. And people always joke when they see me walking, they say, that gentleman, if a goat makes noise, is able to tell you whether it's a male or a female. Really, I've got a passion of goats, and I never had any goats in my life, and I never stayed in the rural areas for too long, unfortunately, but I developed that interest of small ruminants when I had a chance to go to Europe to study. It's surprising, even my father was surprised that how can you just turn around? You're a teacher, now you are an agriculturalist. And he tried to force me to go back to teaching, I refused. And that's when I joined Matopos Research Station in 1985. And I didn't know anything about goats, how to hold a goat, I didn't know. I was taught by junior staff. I came with all those crazy ideas from school, and slowly, slowly, I appreciated what is a goat. And someone was saying, look, let's go to the field and let's check what these goats eat. I said, look, I grew up in town. I can't identify the trees. We which are eaten by gods. But today, I can tell you, I can identify every shrub eaten by a god. That shows interest. Well, that's my background. And I would like to take this opportunity, really, that I'm inspired that at least there is someone who is promoting gods in the country. I've tried to promote gods here and there, but I'm not seeing anything happening on the ground. People come to my office for advice almost every month. I tell them a lot of things about gods. They don't come back. The only thing I tell them, a god is not an easy animal to raise. It's not an easy animal. It's a proud animal. You can't pay it easily, it will jump. You cannot dip it easily, it will jump out of the deep tank. So it's a very funny animal. And you cannot fence it off easily. It will find a hole and come out. That's the story about gods. You have to be very careful. Those who want to go for god farming, you need to go to school first. I can teach you. Well, on goat milk now. I've always been saying that goat milk, when I tell people goat milk is a product from goats and their life. I say, you never know. Because when I talk of goat milk, children will say, they know milk from a milk sachet, with a dairy bowl sachet. They don't know that where milk is coming from. It's now 36 years of independence, and that's when what research started also. It's about 36 years. Immediately after independence, a lot of work or a lot of people got interested in courts. But up to today, no attention has ever been given to goat milk production for human consumption, despite the fact that courts in the dry areas of Zimbabwe, the communities take goat milk, and goats are mainly kept in the dry areas of the country. Most of our people, it has been said, they keep goats for milk, but in the dry areas, they keep them for both meat and milk. There are communities who can tell you how to process goat milk, fresh goat milk at household level. They can ferment it easily. They can do a lot of things with it, get butter or get cream, body cream from them, from the goat milk. I remember a study was done in Malawi where people were trying to introduce goat milk to communities. And they mixed cow's milk and goat milk, and people failed to differentiate goat milk. Why? Because it had been processed so well that you couldn't differentiate it. But we experts, we can differentiate goat milk from cow's milk. Goat milk is so easy to digest or swallow as compared to cow's milk. Goat studies have been undertaken on livestock stations and institutes. Information is available now, but it's so difficult to get. I know some time ago, one minister was already complaining that we keep a lot of information in our offices, we are not disseminating it. But I always say, it's us or it's the communities, they don't tell us what they want. Now, if you want to go to court for court production now, you pretend as if there's nothing in Zimbabwe. But if you visit the institutes I've mentioned, you'll get a lot of information. But it really needs patience. And it's something whereby I always tell people, farming is not easy with goats. You have to have a passion and have time for them. Goat milk fits very well in our economy blueprint. And I'm happy to say that what Tokma has presented is now a topic for us to look at the food security and nutrition cluster matrix and see how goats can be included, especially goat products such as milk. When we talk of meat, we talk of cake, but we have got more than 3 million goats, and when I calculate from the statistics we have about goat milk production, we can produce almost 1 million kilograms of goat milk a day in Zimbabwe. And one was saying, was sitting on gold, and I believe I can say all that milk at the moment, goat milk, is just going to waste. Go to Europe now in any hospital, they've got a tank full of goat milk. Why? Because they know people come with different ailments. Others have got this lactose tolerance. They have to be given goat milk to heal them. In Zimbabwe, we've got 3 million goats. Which hospital has got a tank full of goat milk to cater for people who come with different ailments? Now, I wish there was someone from Ministry of Health here who would take what I'm saying seriously. Why I'm saying about goat milk now in hospitals, it has got very good medicinal properties. Those who suffer from asthma, if they take goat milk, the incidence of asthma are reduced. I've got a typical example of a sister-in-law. I introduced her to goat milk. Now she's no longer having serious attacks of asthma. Some of us might have grown drinking goat milk because our mothers were not producing enough human milk or breast milk. That's a very good substitute. Why? Because goat milk has got small, flat, fat globules, which can easily be digested by any human being. You drink goat milk, cow's milk, you have a running stomach. Drink goat milk, no problem at all. So these are some of the things that I'm happy to talk more talked about HIV positive patients. They are being encouraged in other countries to drink goat milk, and they care on because that's another protein supplement for them, a cheap one. If my memory serves me correct, 20 years ago here in Zimbabwe, especially in Harare, we used to buy goat cheese in Bon Marché. How many of you remember that? Or you're not interested? There was goat cheese in Bon Marché. And this was being produced by the commercial farmers from their commercial goat flocks, the Sanen. The Sanen is a very well-known breed for milk production, a dairy breed. There are very few farmers now. I'm trying to get in contact with them who are still raising Sanen goats for milk production, for home use. Some years ago, the Ministry of the Henderson Research Station received some Sanen goats slaughtered because of a terrible disease which was going to be of economical disaster for us. And they were all slaughtered. Talk more, we have got facilities at Henderson which were built by the French for milk production. Unfortunately, I think Henderson was in the wrong place in Mashona where people don't drink goat milk. If it was at Matopos, I think we'll be very far today. So I'm even encouraging Henderson now to relook at bringing goats which can produce milk, starting with our indigenous goats. So we've got an opportunity there. The products from goat milk, they are very easy. Cheese. There is a recipe for making cheese at household level using goat milk. Just mix goat milk with lemon juice. You get your soft cheese without a problem. I demonstrated that some years ago at the trade fair, and no one was serious about it. No one ever came back to me. I said it's a lost opportunity. Yogurt, very easy. Goat milk. Just to sum up, I would like to urge all of you that next weekend is a long weekend. If you could just go to the communal areas and ask them to milk just half a cup
of goat milk and test it, then give me a call. Just give it a try. You will be impressed. So this study which Tokmo has done, I'm so impressed because at least there is someone outside the Ministry of Agriculture who has really gone further than us to promote goat milk production through the launch of the book. We are at fault. As I mean, I'm also at fault. All that information, I'm supposed to have written so many booklets, but Zimbabweans, when it comes to writing, we are so scared. We feel maybe standards are not that high, but I tell you, I'm working on a goat handbook now. Through pressure, I've been pressurized. I just give myself about 6 months or so, will be through. So that it will assist most of you who are going for goat production. Although I've got one which we wrote, is it goat production as a business being assisted by SNV? Anyone who wants to have a look at that, I can send you through the email so that you can have an idea. It's in a soft copy, so there won't be a problem, just through the SNV. This copy is there for goats, and I will tell you, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not talking about Kedi, the Tuli, Nguni, or Mashona. I would rather talk of the Mashona port and the Matabele port. So on that note, I just want to ask Tokmo before I close, did you bring any goat cheese or goat milk for these people? Because this session is supposed to end with that.
I tried to search for it.
Because that's the only way you can promote your work. At least there should have been a few pieces of goat cheese. I know milk is so difficult, but maybe if it had talked to me, would have thought I did got something from South Africa. But on that note, really, I'm really impressed, and I think you will appreciate my passion which I have for goats, and also for such young people now to take a poor man's cow, which is the goat, and put it at a certain level. I'm really impressed. I think the owners, what's left for us is Nestle. Can we have a small dairy processing plant for goat milk? I know people start saying the numbers are very small, but with time, we cannot. I know Tokmo is talking of importing dairy goats. I don't want to lie to you. It's very complicated. Especially when I'm telling about the disease which was discovered from those southern goats. It needs us to really go back and check. I think around Rua, those former commercial farmers, they still have those ones. I know somebody who can take us there. They can negotiate how best you can have that seed of those animals. Then from there we can spread, cross it with our indigenous animals. I did cross the salmon with Matabele goats. The project was doing very well. So if you need that information, I can always assist you. So, be happy that there is something local which we have. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm really happy and I wish him good luck. Rome was not built in a day. We'll find that maybe in 5 years' time, there might be a goat milk processing plant somewhere in one part of the country, and I'll be there to promote it. Really, we're trying to promote goat production, but I know most people want meat products only. But with meat products, we're still also failing. You go to Australia now, New Zealand, they've got meat pies, goat meat pies. Why not have goat meat pies in Zimbabwe? Nothing stops us from having. We need to diversify, think outside the box, and things will move. I've never tested a goat meat pie, but I think if it is manufactured here, processed here in Zimbabwe, it would be very nice. Because that's organic meat with no chemicals at all, as compared to these high intensive.
protection systems in the world. Thank you. I can talk and talk about this, unfortunately. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Skosana. I believe that you can talk and talk and talk, and I think you did, and I think we are all converted now. So I think as we walk out, even though there may be no milk and no cheese from the goats, I think we will be able to source it as individuals and make sure that we come back to you with our feedback. So thank you for that contribution. At this point, we're going to take a small break, ladies and gentlemen, and the author and his support will be in front here for those who may wish to know a little bit more about the book, and if they so desire, they can also purchase it from here. So for the next 5 to 10 minutes, we'll just take some time to be with the author, and indeed, if we have any questions, please feel free. Thank you.
Thank you. This is my economist.
Proceedings, and what we will do before we then proceed into dinner is that we will have a well-known industrialist, a well-known business leader, and we are very grateful for his acceptance of our invitation, and he has very graciously agreed to come through and give us a vote of thanks before we proceed. So ladies and gentlemen, can I ask that we very warmly welcome Mr. Kumbira Katange. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, colleagues. I specifically asked what to say. Because occasions like this, I think you need to be very good in taking instructions. In many cases, you have much more to say, other than to, I think in the first instance, to thank you, Topmo, for bringing us together. And as Mr. Skosana and the others have said, now I'm sorry, the example that you have set, and the ball that you have set rolling. So thank you very much for bringing us together. And let me thank you, I'm sure, on your behalf, for your family, for coming to encourage you. If all of us had not come and only yourself, I can assure you that would have been enough. And of course, there are people who have participated here, Skosana from the ministry, the ones that and as they see, say, you too, Mr. MC, I think we should also thank you. And I think to thank everybody for coming to acknowledge what the young man has done and is doing. I'm sure in future, because I looked at the back, he has written a trainee like he did. And if he's already putting out an impressive publication like this when he's a trainee, can you imagine when he finishes and he's no longer a trainee? So there's much expectation, Tokmo, from all of us, all the people who are going to buy your publication. And I was saying to you, MIC, it is on Amazon, which means that it's really all over the world now. And I think people are going to be looking forward to the next edition. And not only that, to new publications. So with those few words, it's to say, go forth and do more. I was watching a movie today, or a documentary about ants. There's something that the commentator said which I thought was apt for this occasion. He said, always on the march. So that's what I would say to you, to say, always on the march. Keep up the good work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kasande, for those words. And indeed, that brings us to dinner. And as we do so, I think as we round up what it is that we have been doing, we talk about watching a movie. It must be something to do with our ages. I was also watching a movie. but mine was slightly different. It was a documentary of something done by the University of Southern California. You know, I think the world over, for many, many years, successful people have been studied. And the reason why we do this is because I think as individuals, we all yearn to be successful. And one of the best ways in which to do it is simply to study those that have done it, and then to do what it is that they have done in the hope that we can repeat their success. And one of the things that came out of this study is that successful people are very intensely action-oriented. They always take action. And the question in their minds is always, what next? What next? And I think what you have done, Tokmo, is very much the action. And it proves what the University of Southern California discovered in their nationwide survey. And they simply asked one question, no more, just one question. How many times do human beings attempt a new idea before they give up? How many times do you think, ladies and gentlemen? How many times do human beings attempt a new idea before they give up? You're almost there, actually. Yeah, but the answer
was less than once.
It's less than once. So the moral of it all is that we really need to be prepared to keep trying again and again and again. And it is the people who continue like you have done to keep trying and knocking on that door while the rest of us give up, who eventually occupy that very rare place at the top. Because there's not much room, there is lots of room there. All of us are here at the bottom. So keep going there. You'll find that there will not be very much company. But thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Dinner is served, and we hope that you enjoy the rest of your evening, and thank you for your support.
Okay. yeah. I'll do it.